What a new one.
In 2016, Netflix entered an already booming entertainment market in Africa and released its first African original, Nigerian drama Lionheart, in 2019. As much as creating local narratives, the global streaming giant is also set to take a piece from the entertainment boom in the continent, with nearly 193 million subscribers globally. Recently, two new African original productions have been released. Poacher, the first Kenyan film released on Netflix, uses drama instead of documentary to show the lives of everyday people involved in poaching. According to the World Wildlife Foundation, if the slaughter continues, elephants will be extinct by 2040. The producers of the film had difficulties until signing with Netflix.
So this has really been a process for us. It took about 2 years from initial writing to actually starting shooting, and then another 2 years to get it onto Netflix. Raising money, we begged, borrowed, and almost stole. We went the crowdfunder route.
The star of the film, Brian Ogola, hopes the film will bring even more attention to this cruelty.
That's very exciting. It's also a bit nerve-wracking, seeing as Netflix is the biggest platform for online streaming content. So we're just looking forward to seeing how people will respond to it. And hopefully we'll take a few more steps towards actualizing the whole vision of Poacher.
The second film released is Oluture. It's a Nigerian thriller about a journalist whose world falls apart after she goes undercover as a sex worker. The film joins a host of other Nigerian films on the platform, most of which are lavish soap opera-like productions that fall short on reflecting Nigerian society. But Oluture is shot on the gritty streets of the capital Lagos, with a portrayal of impoverished sex workers lured into being trafficked overseas.
And I feel like people need to see how these things happen so that we can help do something about it, so that we can help stop it, whether it's trying to help young women, trying to empower young women to find other ways and other solutions to figuring out their lives rather than going on this horrible journey.
Human Rights Watch ranks Nigeria a top origin country of trafficking victims in Europe and elsewhere.
It's a very vicious world. So I'm very happy that this conversation has started, so that governments will sit up to their responsibility, so that the agencies that are tasked with fighting human trafficking in Nigeria will, maybe clamor for more funding or sit up and do better.
What if something has happened to her?
This is also the first film following a multi-title deal between Netflix and Nigeria's Ebony Life TV, the production company of Oluture. The deal is only one among many partnerships to promote African productions. As Netflix's head of African originals, Dorothy Getube, says, we are diving all in when it comes to Africa. We're not just dipping our toes. Things are only expected to accelerate from this point on.
First of all, you start slowly.
Let's go to James Williams. He's a professor of modern French literature and film at the Royal Holloway, London University. Hi, it's lovely to have you on Showcase today. I appreciate you coming. So, let's start with this. I want to find out what you think about Netflix's African movies strategy in general.
Well, it's in a sense predictable. It was coming. They've been around in Africa across the whole continent for 5 years. What they want to do is to acquire original content for one of their key growth markets. And in terms of the brand, they want to expand and promote that and want to be seen offering local productions for the region. So it makes perfect business sense. It's a commercial proposition and entirely expected.
Okay, so you said that it was predictable, but were you predicting that they would come up with content like this? I mean, it was predictable that they would come up with some content because obviously the African industry is getting bigger and bigger. But are you happy with what you're seeing?
Well, there, I'm not so happy, to be honest. I mean, and in a sense, again, it was predictable that Netflix operates according to in a large part, feature films. And what they have done is to turn to a predictable source of feature films in sub-Saharan Africa. And I should make the point very clear that we're talking here about sub-Saharan Africa, not North Africa, which falls under a different region, the Middle East. So we're talking about sub-Saharan Africa, and what they've gone for is essentially Nollywood. That's the film industry, which is second largest in the world, in Nigeria. There are some other films on the collection which come from Ghana, so-called Gollywood, and also from Tanzania, so-called Swahilihood, and South Africa. But essentially, we're talking about an Anglophone series of films. So it's actually very limited, and I think, again, I did expect that. We can talk about some of the titles individually, but overall, it's conforming to a certain idea people already have of African film, which is Nollywood. And that comes with a whole set of sort of rules and conventions, if you like. In particular, around genre. This is a genre-driven narrative cinema. So what we're seeing on the list, and I should say it's the first list they produced, so this is just the start, and hopefully it will expand and diversify. But what we're seeing are essentially films in English and conforming to genres of rom-com, action cinema, thriller, spy, comedies. And that's about it. Some of them, which have just been created with Netflix, are very, very good and are very well made and entertaining, which is what Netflix wants. And that's its brand, its entertainment.
Okay. So, wow, there's a lot to unpack there. So let's just do it together. Which ones do you think are good? I mean, Netflix originals from sub-Saharan Africa, I mean. And then I really want to understand what you think should be there instead of what they have. But let's come back to that. I want you to tell us which ones are good, do you think?
Okay, well, let's start with the original, Netflix's first original African series, which is Queen Sono. And it's had its first season, and Netflix has now commissioned a second season. Now, this corresponds, again, to a very clear genre. This is the spy thriller. And it takes place across the continent, across sub-Saharan Africa, at least. And it's very exciting, it's very savvy, it's smart, all the things that Netflix does very well. But again, I mean, although there is in the narrative the lead female character, a backstory with her mother being in the anti-apartheid campaign in South Africa during the apartheid era, that is quickly forgotten. And what counts is this sort of swirling, exciting, trans-African experience. I think that is probably the most exciting aspect of Netflix, that it has the capacity, it has the money, clearly, to make such a large production work very well. Mm-hmm. But it is according to the strict boundaries of genre. So what we're not seeing are some new ideas about Africa, essentially. Another example would be the film called Lionheart, which is, in fact, a Nigerian film, so a Nollywood film. And again, very well made and very interesting on one level. It's a dynasty film. It's about a very strong female character, the daughter of an ailing father who needs his company to survive, and the daughter steps in. So it's a very sort of strong, empowering role for the female, lead female character. And that's very good, and it works very well. But again, it's strictly according to genre, and we're not seeing... But we're not seeing, in a sense, what life is like in Nigeria. And this is the problem I have with Nollywood in general.
This is really interesting, James. Unfortunately, we're running out of time, so I want to move on quickly to exactly where you brought us to. What do you think should there be instead of what they have at the moment?
Well, I think what Netflix has to do, and this is the challenge for Netflix, is to go beyond the Anglophone cinemas of sub-Saharan Africa. It's got to tap into new areas, for example, Ethiopia or Angola. and give us a sense of the diversity of Africa. I mean, the mistake would be to confine itself to Nollywood, to the Nollywood model, which is fine for Nollywood, but if Nollywood wants to expand and do new things and have alternative voices and show new stories, then like Netflix, it's got to expand and diversify. So Netflix has a chance here, an amazing chance, because Amazon Prime, Disney Plus are not around yet. They have, in a sense, the lion's share of this market. They want 5 million subscribers to Netflix. That's only by 2025. And that's only going to work if they can create stories and show Africa in new ways. That's the challenge. And we'll have to see how it works out. The signs are promising, and they are commissioning some films which are going to be made not in English, but in East and West African languages, original languages. So that looks promising. And they have someone like John Bayoga, a bona fide Hollywood star, British Nigerian, to help them do that. So this is really the moment. It's I think, a watershed moment for African cinema. This is a chance for Netflix to help it move forward and to show images which are not being seen currently globally. Because I should say, I mean, perhaps the obvious point here, that what Netflix is not doing is giving us sort of art cinema. It's not that type of operation. It's not showing films which are shown in festivals as African cinema. It's entertainment, and it wants a big global audience. For that, it needs diversity.
Wow, James, it was lovely talking to you. This was really informative. Thanks a lot for bringing your expertise on Showcase today, but unfortunately, we're out of time. Thank you.